Thank you very much, Mr. Towns. First, let me thank you for yielding, but also for your leadership on this issue and for so many other issues. Your voice is extremely important. Your work has been important and continues to be quite amazing. Coming from New York, I come from California, we have very similar issues that we have to deal with in terms of this horrific energy crisis. And so thank you for giving us the opportunity to talk about it one more time. And also, I just say, as I'm listening to my colleague, Mr. Johnson from Georgia, I just want to say thank you for that very brilliant presentation and the historical context. You know, sometimes we forget the past. In Ghanaian language, in the Akan language, there's a term called Sankofa. In order to move forward, we must look back at our mistakes. And I think what you talked about tonight really makes it very clear that we have to understand how we got to where we are so that we don't make those mistakes again, such as you talked about the drilling in the pristine area in Alaska and Anwar, and all of the proposals that this administration wants to embark upon. And so thank you very much for that. And to my colleague from Texas, Ms. Jackson Lee, you know, you have been on this for many, many years. You come from oil country, and you understand very clearly the oil industry and what we need to do to dig ourselves out of this hole. And so your voice continues to be important coming from Texas, understanding that the American people deserve not to have to pay $5 a gallon per gas. And the courage that you've displayed has been amazing. And thank you for your voice and your leadership. As we work to reduce skyrocketing prices at the pump, we continue to face opposition from the Bush administration. And our colleagues on the other side of the aisle seem to be content to subsidize the big oil companies' record profits that Mr. Towns talked about and that you talked about, Mr. Johnson and Ms. Jackson Lee, their record profits quarter after quarter, rather than adopt a real solution to meet the energy needs of people across our nation. More specifically, we have proposed legislation that would invest in true, clean, and renewable energy sources. Our proposals would also bring much-needed accountability, which we need desperately, to the energy markets in order to eliminate the price gouging. You hear me? Price gouging that's taking place. And market manipulation and speculation that have inflated energy prices to record levels. This week, we will also take up legislation to expand the use of public transit systems to save energy and reduce greenhouse gas emissions. But in light of this growing energy crisis, I cannot help but also reflect upon the Bush administration's determination to squander our resources on the immoral occupation of Iraq that has directly contributed to the current economic downturn and the high gas prices of that the American people are seeing at the pump. Make no mistake, we are in the middle of the Bush-Iraq recession. The economic hardships that Americans face today is the direct result of this administration's failed and flawed policies at home and abroad. When President Bush was in office, and when he took office, in January of 2001, the price of oil was $23 a barrel and gasoline costs at as little as, I think it was about $1.35 per gallon. Now, after more than 5 years of bombing and bloodshed in Iraq since the Iraq invasion, oil has topped $130 a barrel, and gasoline is averaging more than $4 per gallon, and as Mr. Johnson said, probably will hit the unfortunate cost of $5 per gallon. By some estimates, the war and continued occupation of Iraq could cost the United States more than $3 trillion. $3 trillion. That's a $3 trillion bill for this administration's failed policies in Iraq that our children and grandchildren will be paying for years to come. The American people recognize the toll this immoral occupation has taken on our economy. They're in dire need of assistance. Many face the impossible choice of buying food for their families or purchasing the gasoline they need to go to work. If we want to see prices at the gas pump go down, one of the first and most essential steps we must take is to end the war and occupation in Iraq. We must also focus on transitioning our economy away from fossil fuels to the greener alternative fuels of the future. This will be a long-term process that will affect communities throughout our nations in different ways. But it's very important to note that as we continue to forge these new frontiers to achieve energy independence and safeguard the environment, communities will face many complex environmental and public health challenges. The drastic acceleration of greenhouse gas emissions has often been concentrated in low-income and minority communities, putting these vulnerable populations on the front lines of the fight against environmental degradation and global climate change. The communities in my district, like in Mr. Johnson's district, Mr. Towns's district, Ms. Jackson Lee's district, we all face the severe consequences of pollution, urban sprawl, and environmental injustice, which harshly affects people of color and low-income communities. This epidemic, sadly, is hitting our children the hardest. For example, back at home, in my own district, children grow up in an area of West Oakland. They're 7 times more likely to be hospitalized for asthma than the average child in California. None of us can afford to take this lightly. The health of our community and neighbors affects all of us. I would also like to just take a moment and recognize the role that California's East Bay is playing at the forefront of the green jobs and green industry movement, which is really a critical part in terms of addressing the energy crisis. One of the most exciting and inclusive solutions to the many issues facing environmental health and our energy crisis is the possibility afforded to us by promoting green jobs training and the growth of the green economy in America. A true green economy, one that is sincere in its mission and deeply rooted in local communities and businesses, can provide innovative answers to many of the problems that our environment faces. Green jobs provide pathways out of poverty for those most affected by environmental injustice, namely people of color and our urban youth. We have been working in my district closely with the Ella Baker Center and the Apollo Alliance. Mayor Ron Dellums, my predecessor here and our colleague, has been working very hard on a new initiative to support the development of green model cities and to focus on economic development through green job training academies and to create a national green institute to serve as a clearinghouse for the green movement. So there are many, many initiatives that we need to look forward in terms of providing for an alternative to our dependence on foreign oil. Most recently, let me just conclude by saying and reminding the country that the Bush administration has threatened to veto the House-passed H.R. 5351, which is the Renewable Energy and Energy Conservation Tax Act of 2008. This legislation makes critical investments in clean and renewable energy and energy efficiency that will create hundreds of thousands of new jobs and help to maintain the United States' position as a leader in innovation as we move toward true energy independence. So I have to thank my colleagues again, especially the Congressional Black Caucus and Congressman Towns, for allowing us to come down for an hour to talk about the basic components and reasons for this energy crisis, and also to provide what we see as some real and practical solutions that we can embrace right now, not next year, but today, if in fact the Bush administration and his oil industry administration would accept the fact that they're responsible for this energy crisis and the American people deserve a way out. Thank you.
Let me thank the gentlewoman from California.